secrets that I'm going to share today fall into these three categories. So we're going to start with verbal language. Verbal language includes words that we say and words that we don't say. I divide words into two categories. There are power words, and power words are words that we can use that can maximize our influence and our ability to persuade our audience. Or power words can also be powerful in the negative impact they can have on your audience and on your impression. So there are some power words to say and some power words to avoid. And then on the other side, there are wimpy words or weak words. These are words that diminish our confidence, our impressions, they dilute our message, and detract from our power. So let's take a look at some words. Starting with power words are words that empower us and empower our message. Here are some examples. There's research that shows that our name is our most favorite word or words in the world. They're our absolute favorite. One of the things that I do as a presenter is I introduce myself to at least a few people before I do a presentation. And then, as I go through my presentation, I drop names. So I know many of you in this room, but I don't know all of you. The ones that I don't know or didn't know before we walked in this room, you're hearing your names. I've already used Rich's. I think I've used Maria's. I know I've used John's. One of the things I do with names is when I say someone's name, that means they know that I'm on their radar. So for example, Ron and I were talking before the meeting started. So right now, Ron's here for Joe. He knows that he's in the center of my radar. But it's not just Ron that's in the center of my radar. Rich, Ray, sorry, don't know your name. And Tiffany are also on the radar. So Ron's ears are really perked up, and their ears are a little bit perked up because they know that my attention is close to them. So that's one of the reasons I sprinkle names throughout the presentation. It also makes Ron and Rich and Tiffany feel important. They're like, man, speaking of my name. And it makes them feel good. And I'm glad. Hope you do feel good.
Do I strike
words are related to expressing our opinion. There's research that shows that we respect people who have a strong opinion, regardless of whether we agree with their opinion or not. We have strong impressions of people who can say, yes, this is what I think we should do, or no, this is not what I think we should do, even if your audience disagrees. So in a business setting, I've seen this work where your client comes to you and says, Carla, can we still do this on budget? And when a client asks you, can we still do this on budget or on time? We're really hesitant to say no. When we can confidently say, I'm sorry, Wendy. Based on the information I have, this is going to be 2 weeks beyond our timeline, or it's going to be about $1,000 over budget. That's more respectful and makes a more solid impression than saying, I don't know, I'll think about it. When we hedge, we seem wishy-washy. So avoid being wishy-washy. That's fun to say, wishy-washy. Say wishy-washy.
Wishy-washy.
I don't know if that's a power word or a wimpy word. It's just fun to say. Another set of power words are about experience. And I can tell you, both as a global training director, where I was in a company, a technology company, that really understood technology, did not understand training and how long it takes to develop a quality training program. I would have my VP come to me and say, we have a new program that's coming out in October, and it's going to be frozen. The program will be frozen in September. So we need a new training program by October. You have 2-3 weeks to design a quality training program. I could say to my boss, we can produce a training program by October. In my experience, though, the quality of that training program is going to lead to more support calls and more client dissatisfaction than if we took the 6 to 8 weeks that it actually takes to design a quality training program. I also use this with clients and with prospects, where let's say I propose option A and option B in a proposal to a client. I can say, in my experience, clients who start off with option A usually upgrade to option B in 4 to 6 months. So if you start with option B, we're going to be 4 to 6 months ahead of the game. If you start with option B, that's based on my experience working with other clients. How might you use this? Or how do you, if you already do?
I just say my experience of working with a client on saying working on their image, this is what happened if we only did this part, but if we added the shopping to the closet, then you get that much more out of the experience.
Yeah. Well, the other thing that I like about in my experience is that it's not debatable. My experience is not right or wrong. So Derek can't come to me and say, well, your experience is wrong. It's not a question of right or wrong. So it allows me to speak my opinion clearly and confidently in a way that's not debatable.